Good morning. How's everybody doing this morning? Wonderful. Are we ready to praise the Lord? All right. Will everyone please stand? Shame and sinfulness rose again victorious. Faithfulness none can deny, through the storm and through the fire there is truth.
Praise God. Good morning to everybody. And thank you for being here. Our 28th annual celebration, church anniversary, as we said last week, called it anniversary, annual anniversary. But it's good to have you here. If you're a visitor, thank you so much for being with us this morning. And if you're a first-time visitor, we have a visitor card. And if you haven't received one of those, if you'll just flag one of those gentlemen down in the green jackets in the back, and they can get you one. And if you'll fill that out and put it in the offering plate when it comes around, we'd greatly appreciate it. It'd be an opportunity for us to be able to minister to you or pray for you. So we appreciate you being here. We're excited what God has done for the last 28 years and excited for what he's going to do for however long he leaves us here. So praise God that he's given us this opportunity. This morning we want to start out after this song to just pray and ask God to continue to bless this service and the rest of this day. So let's pray. Father, we come before you. We thank you for this day. God, you're so good to us, Lord. Lord, you are stronger. There's no God beside you, Lord. You're God of all, God above all, Lord. And we thank you for being our Father, Lord. We thank you for being a God that loves us and supplies our every need, Lord. We thank you for dying on the cross for our sins and rising again on that third day, Lord, to give us life, to give us hope of our future with you, Lord. And we thank you for loving us that much. And Lord, I thank you for Trinity Baptist Temple. Thank you for the people of Trinity Baptist Temple. Lord, there's people that are here this morning that have been here for 28 years, Lord, serving you, loving each other, and serving this community, God. And I just thank you for them. And I thank you for each person that have joined this church body along the way. God, it's a blessing to see what you can do with a group of people that's just willing to serve you, love you, and love one another. And God, I thank you for them. Lord, I thank you for, again, just this opportunity to be here this morning. And God, as we continue to sing, I pray that your hand just be on the music, Lord, on the message. I pray that you're honored, God, that our hearts this morning would be encouraged, but they'd be challenged. Lord, that your will would be done in this service. We'll praise you for it all, and we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Joyful, joyful, we adore thee. Let's pray and bless the offering this morning. Heavenly Father, we come to you in prayer. We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings. We thank you, Father, for all the things that you give us and do for us. We pray, Father, this morning that you bless the things that we've done with our hands. Help us to have that we can give to you and to your kingdom for your work. Help us to care about the kingdom the way that you do, dear Lord God, and to put something back. Father, we love you. We thank you. We ask that you bless all those that are able to give, those that may not be able to. But we just want it to be for your work and for your kingdom. And we give you all the praise, honor, and glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
saw a blind man tapping along, losing his way as he passed through the throng. Tears filled my eyes, I said, friend, you can't see, but with a smile on his face, he replied to me.
I see all my friends in Hallelujah Square. What a wonderful time we'll all have up there. We'll sing and praise Jesus, His glory share, and we'll all live forever in Hallelujah Square.
I saw a cripple dragging his feet. He couldn't walk like we do down the street. I said, my friend, I feel sorry for you, but he said, up in heaven, I'll walk just like you. I saw an old man gasping for breath. Soon he be gone as his eyes closed in death. But he looked at me and said, don't look so blue, I'm going to heaven. How about you?
I'll see all my friends in Hallelujah Square. What a wonderful time we'll all have up there. We'll sing and praise Jesus, His glory to share, and we'll all live forever in Hallelujah Square.
To be a child of God.
Amen.
And I just like a little prayer, just to say that I just ask Jesus to please put His hand on all our sick, and just His healing hand on our sick. And I just want to thank Him so much. Just love being a part of this family, and I just hope that all the visitors and everyone that is a part of this family just love on Jesus. Just call Him when you need Him. And I'll start crying. So I just love Him, and I hope y'all love Him too.
Victory in Jesus.
On holy ground.
Praise God. Amen. Yeah. That's an amazing thing to think about, the presence of God, you know, and to be the temple of God individually and as a church, the temple of a holy God is just an amazing thing. But praise God. If you got your Bibles, you can go ahead and turn over to Psalms chapter 106. Again, we want to thank you so much if you're a guest with us this morning for being here. It's an honor to have you. Thank you so much. We hope that everyone's made plans to stay with us for lunch afterwards because this is going to be good. And I just have to say, I put a disclaimer out there. They had told me originally that we were going to do chicken parmesan, right? Is that right? Chicken Alfredo. Well, if some of you know me, and I am not an Italian person, but I know that a lot of people, Italian food lover, a lot of people like that. So I was like, yeah, praise God, a lot of people love that. Great, let's go with it, no problem. But I will tell you, I think it's the favor of the Lord, because I walked down the hall this morning after prayer, and I walked by the kitchen, and there was just a bunch of slabs of meat in these containers. And I was like, oh, praise the Lord. I don't even know what happened, but praise God. They said, well, you know, we couldn't get the other stuff, so we got this stuff. And I said, God was listening. That's praying. Oh, I'm just joking. I wasn't praying for meat, but it's good stuff anyways. But hopefully you made plans because it looked really good, and I know the people cooking it do an amazing job. So hopefully you'll be here with us and to do that. This morning I'm going to preach a message entitled Standing in the Breach. Standing in the Breach. What's a breach? A breach, according to the dictionary, is a gap or a hole in a wall or a barrier or a hole, a gap or a crack in a defense, and especially one that's made by an attacking enemy. That's what the dictionary says is the definition of a breach. There's truth is this, that there are many holes, there's many cracks, gaps, in the fabric of our world. There's a lot of cracks, there's a lot of holes, a lot of gaps in the fabric of our nation. In Christianity, there's a lot of gaps. And if they're not shored up, if we don't shore up these things that are glaring in many respects, if someone or some people don't stand up, if churches don't stand in the gaps, then I believe that judgment is imminent. You say, wow, it's a great way to start the sermon, you know. Judgment is imminent, you know. But I think it's the truth. I think that the enemy is looking for whatever way he can enter in and make a mess of what God intends to do. He'll do it in the church. He'll start anywhere he can. Anywhere he'll find a gap, anywhere he'll find a hole, the enemy will come in and try to destroy. Again, he'll do it in the home. What happens when a husband and wife, they get going at each other and there's a little bit of division there? Satan loves to rush in like a flood and make that gap even wider. He sees a little bit of opportunity. He wants to make the best or the worst of the situation. I believe that the enemy will come in. I believe that judgment is imminent, or both of them combined, if people don't stand in the gap. People don't stand in the breach. Trinity Baptist Temple has been a church that's been filled with people that have been willing to stand in the gap for 28 years. Now, not everyone at all times has been a part of the church for 28 years. Has stood in the gap, so to say. But for 28 years, there have been, and there still are, many people that are willing and have stood in the breach. This morning, before we get any further into the message, I'd like to recognize some of the long-standing members. We do this every year, but I got to thinking as the Lord had put this on my heart to preach, and I thought, man, we've had some amazing things that God has done in this church and through this church. And there have been people that have for years stood up and said, no, we're going to stand for the right. No, we're going to make a stand in our community. This church has picketed pornography. This church has sent letters to Congress, representatives. This church has done a lot of things to say, no, we're not going to allow the gaps to be here. And again, not everybody at all times has done this, but there have been some people from the very beginning who have done that. And so I want to acknowledge, again, the long-standing members, starting with the charter members. So if you are here, you're present, and you are a charter member of Trinity Baptist Temple, please stand. From the very beginning, charter members, please stand. Amen. And does somebody have a camera or an iPhone or something good? Yeah, 50 people plus. I honestly, I know some of you can't, but if y'all will come down here, I'd like to get a picture. I like this, that we do this every year. The charter members, if y'all will come right down here up front, y'all come on down, charter members, come on down. And if somebody with a good camera there, we'll get a good picture. Who? Oh, Brother Michael, man, Johnny on the spot. Yes, sir. Y'all come down here and stand in the middle, and so we can get a picture of them. What an awesome, awesome, awesome thing. Charter members of Trinity Baptist Temple. And there's some more, too. I think some of them are in the back. Oh, wait, Brother Michael. Brother Michael, we got a couple more coming here. I was like, I saw some people standing over here. This right here is an amazing testimony, amazing blessing right there. Praise God. One more time. Praise God. Amen. Praise the Lord. If you've been a member of Trinity Baptist Temple for 27 years, please stand. 27 years. You weren't here at the very beginning, but you came right after. 26 years. And if you'll stay standing, please, I know we're going to try to go through it quick. 26 years. Praise God. Amen. 25 years. Praise God. Please stay standing. 24 years. 23. 23. 22. Amen. That's a blessing right there standing. 21 years. Amen. 20 years. God. 19. 18. There we go. We had one that couldn't stand with his family because he wasn't born yet. That's praise God. 17. Oh, there's one popping up back there. 16 years. 15 years. Well, that was a good year. 14 years. Praise God. Praise God. 13. 12, we're going to 10, just to let you know, 12 years. Praise God. 11. Amen. And if you've been here for 10 years, please stand. Amen. There's another one that was here in the womb. But praise God. There were several. Let's give all these a round of applause. Praise God. Thank you so much. Amazing. Now, there are a lot of you who have been here recently. We want to acknowledge you, too. For members that have been members anywhere from 5 years to 10 years. So you're 9 years, eight, seven, six, 5 years. 5 years to 10 years. Please stand. Praise God. Amen. You'll be seated. I want to just say something. If you look around the room at the people standing, these people are working or workers and from the ones from 5 to 10 years. And those of you who have been members in the last 5 years, I just want to thank you so much for being, because you have come right into our church and you've been faithful and you've been serving, and all of you are blessings. So to Trinity Baptist Temple membership, thank you so much for everything you do for the Lord and for this church. So I just praise God for you. I heard a neurosurgeon this last week, and some of you probably have seen this on the news, but he was speaking at the National Prayer Breakfast, Presidential Prayer Breakfast, and there's been a lot of stink on his speech that he gave at that prayer breakfast. I liked his speech, but I understand what the criticism has been. Because it seemed that he, knocked all the president's thoughts and or his positions, and it was supposed to be a prayer breakfast. It wasn't supposed to be, a politic type deal. And a lot of people said that he turned it into that. But I was listening to his speech, and in his speech, he gave an account of the War of 1812, and it just got me thinking, man, because I've been preparing for this, and I thought, man, what an amazing account that he gave. Many people might know what happened in the story that he gave. Some of you might not. Some of you might not have ever heard it, but most of us who have taken American history know this account, but I want to recount a little bit. He summarized how the British had determined that we as a young little nation were pretty much in over our heads. We'd got in over water that's too high for us, and so they decided they were going to come in and attack us and colonize us as a British, colony again. So they went destroying from the north. They came up the eastern seaboard. They were attacking all over. They went into Washington, D.C. They burned down the Capitol. Next, they turned their eyes to Baltimore, Maryland. As they headed into the Chesapeake Bay there, there was this great armada of British ships that were coming in. Now, Britain had forces on the ground as well, and they were coming to take Fort McHenry. Fort McHenry stood there, and what a lot of people didn't know is that Major Armistead had already ordered this large garrison flag to be flown at all times in front of the fort as a symbol that we were a nation, and we weren't going to fall to anybody. Large, huge flag, larger than the ones they fly today as garrison flags. They also made a storm flag that was flown during times of storm that was a little bit smaller. But the British ships came in, and the admiral that was leading that fleet saw this flag in the harbor of the Chesapeake Bay, and he ordered that flag to be taken down before dusk. And he warned them, if you don't take the flag down before dusk, I'm going to reduce you and your fort to ashes. There was an amateur poet aboard one of those ships, and he was also a lawyer sent by President Madison to petition the release of a civilian doctor who had supposedly been helping people flee from the British invasion. And so they took him captive, and this lawyer, this amateur poet, was on board, and he was sent to, again, petition release. However, they were successful in their petition, but they overheard the plans of the British. So the British were not going to let them go because they were going to attack the fort at by dusk if they didn't lower the flag. They were going to attack them anyways, but they decided to hold the men captive there in the hold. Dusk approached, and Francis Scott Key mourned for his young nation. He knew what was coming. He knew it was imminent. And as dusk fell, he heard the bombardments overhead. He heard the shells ringing out. He heard the bombs bursting in air, shrapnel raining down on top of the fort, destroying a lot of people. Debris so thick that he struggled to see, is the flag still there? They estimated that the ship was probably about 8 miles off the shore. The attack went all through the night. Many attempts by the British Army were made even on land. And there were 1,000 men that were there in that fort, Fort McHenry, that defended that attack on land, that pushed them back. And all the shells and all the bombs that rained down on that fort, again, were just a harassment all through the night to those thousand men. Finally, dawn came, the sun rose, and being 8 miles offshore with smoke and everything still going, he struggled to see, was the flag still there? The flag still there, because he knew if the flag was still waving in the air, it was still upright, he knew that the fort had defended itself and that we as a nation were still alive, that we weren't going back into the oppression that we came out of originally. And to his joy, he saw that flag waving. What he didn't know as he was there on that ship hold, 8 miles offshore, he couldn't see. He could see the flag waving, but he couldn't see the brave men that took turns all through the night holding that flag up. And as the bombs bursted and shrapnel rained down and took the many lives that stood there and held that flag up and laid there, he still knew the flag was waving. He didn't know how many men were standing in the gap. He didn't know how many men were standing in the breach. And all of those men did. They defended that fort. They stood their ground. They held that flag up. They were not going to back down. And every way possible, they stood in the breach. Every way possible, those men were holding the fabric of our nation together. The War of 1812 saw its turning point that day. A treaty wasn't too far off after that. But today, again in our nation, 200 years later, it was the War of 1812, here we are, 2013, 200 years later, our nation is definitely under attack. Our nation definitely has a lot of gaps, a lot of breaches, and the enemy has found and he's pushing through to destroy. There's a lot of things that are lacking in our world today. A lot of breaches that necessitate a righteous God's judgment as well if something doesn't change. If people don't change. People don't do something. In our text today, we're going to see a man that was willing to stand in the gap for a nation, for a people who had gone astray. A man that was willing to stand in the breach when a righteous God's judgment was about to fall. This nation had missed the boat. They had opened the door for the devil, and the devil was about to just have a heyday. Again, God was about to pour out judgment. He had already come in like a flood. He had already caused so much damage with the nation of Israel, but it was about to happen again. Again, God was very upset, ready to destroy his own inheritance, ready to destroy his own people. But there was a man. There was a man willing to stand. So let's pray and let's read. Father, we come before you. Thank you so much for this day. I thank you so much for Trinity Baptist Temple, Lord. Thank you so much for the men and the women who through the years have stood in the many breaches that we've seen in our nation, Lord, in the breaches in Christianity, in our world. Lord, I thank you for those that are still doing it today. But Lord, honestly, it feels like the ground's slipping out from underneath us. In many respects, it feels like there's not very much hope. But God, I pray that this morning we would open our hearts, that we would look with spiritual eyes and listen with spiritual ears and see that you are still God. You're still on the throne. And we don't know the timetable, only you do. And so God, give us what we need this morning to be those people willing to stand in the breach or to stand in the gap no matter what. So God, just move now. Speak to our hearts and we'll praise you for all that you do in Jesus' name. Amen. If you'll look in Psalm chapter 106, we're just going to read through this for the most part. At verse 1, it says, "Praise ye the Lord, O give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. Who can utter the mighty acts of the Lord? Who can show forth all his praise? Blessed are they that keep judgment, and he that doeth righteousness at all times. Remember me, O Lord, with the favor that thou bearest unto thy people. O visit me with thy salvation, that I may see the good of thy chosen, that I may rejoice in the gladness of thy nation, that I may glory with thine inheritance. We have sinned with our fathers. We have committed iniquity. We have done wickedly. Our fathers understood not thy wonders in Egypt. They remembered not the multitude of thy mercies, but provoked him at the sea, even at the Red Sea, Nevertheless, he saved them for his name's sake, that he might make his mighty power to be known. He rebuked the Red Sea also, and it was dried up. So he led them through the depths as through the wilderness. And he saved them from the hand of him that hated them, and redeemed them from the hand of the enemy. And the waters covered their enemies, and there was none of them left. Then believed they his words. They sang his praise. Sadly, verse 13, they soon forgot his works. They waited not for his counsel, but lusted exceedingly in the wilderness and tempted God in the desert. And he gave them their request, but sent leanness to their soul. Now I want you to picture for just a second how much this might be a picture of even America today. He gave them their request, filled them with everything that their fleshly lust desired, but there was leanness in their soul and their spiritual lives. They envied Moses also in the camp, and Aaron, the saint of the Lord. The earth opened and swallowed up Dathan and covered the company of Abiram. And a fire was kindled in their company. The flame burned up the wicked. They made a calf in Horeb and worshipped the molten image. Thus they changed their glory into the similitude of an ox that eateth grass. They forget God, their Savior, which had done great things in Egypt, wondrous works in the land of Ham, and terrible things, or great and terrible things by the Red Sea. Listen to verse 23. Therefore he said that he would destroy them. Had not Moses, his chosen, stood before him in the breach to turn away his wrath, lest he should destroy them. Yea, they despised the pleasant land. They believed not his word, but murmured in their tents and hearkened not to the voice of the Lord. Therefore he lifted up his hand against them to overthrow them in the wilderness, to overthrow their seed also among the nations and to scatter them in the lands. They joined themselves also to Baal Peor and ate the sacrifices of the dead. Thus they provoked him to anger with their inventions, and the plague break in upon them. Verse 30, then stood up Phinehas and executed judgment. He also stood in the breach. And so the plague was stayed, and that was counted unto him for righteousness unto all generations forevermore. They angered him also at the waters of strife, so that it went ill with Moses for their sake, because they provoked his spirit, so that he spake unadvisedly with his lips. They did not destroy the nations concerning whom the Lord commanded them, but were mingled among the heathen and learned their works. Listen to this. And they served their idols, which were a snare unto them. Yea, they sacrificed their sons and their daughters unto devils, and shed innocent blood, even the blood of their sons and their daughters, whom they sacrificed unto the idols of Canaan. And the land was polluted with blood. Thus were they defiled with their own works, and went a whoring with their own inventions. Therefore was the wrath of the Lord kindled against his people, insomuch that he abhorred his own inheritance. And he gave them into the land of the heathen, and they that hated them ruled over them. Listen to this. And they gave them into the hand of the heathen, and they that hated them ruled over them. What a miserable experience. Their enemies also oppressed them, and they were brought into subjection under their hand. Many times did he deliver them, but they provoked him with their counsel and were brought low for their iniquity. Verse 44, nevertheless, he regarded their affliction when he heard their cry. And he remembered for them his covenant and repented according to the multitude of his mercies. He made them also to be pitied of all those that carried them captives. Save us, O Lord our God, and gather us from among the heathen to give thanks unto thy holy name and to triumph in thy praise. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel from everlasting to everlasting. And let the people say, Amen. Praise ye the Lord. With men and women who are standing in the gap, those that are doing it, those who are willing, there are some definite characteristics this morning that I want to talk about. They're present in their lives. Israel was in a desperate situation when Moses stood in the gap. God's wrath was kindled against his people, and he was going to destroy them for the idol worship, for the stiffness of their necks, for the sin that they had gone lusting after, for the sacrifice of their children to false gods. He was going to destroy them. And hardness of heart. But Moses stood in the breach. Moses begged God, God, please don't do this. Please don't destroy them. Another man that mentioned was Phinehas. They had gone after and married heathen people, and they had learned their inventions. They were worshiping. They were eating meats offered to idols. They were doing exactly what God had commanded them not to. And they were rejoicing. And one came in the camp rejoicing that he had joined himself in sin to a heathen woman. And you know what? Phinehas said enough. He runs in, and it's a pretty gory story, but he thrust them both through with a sword or with a spear. And the plague was stayed, the Bible said. Nation was completely off track. People that were completely off track. In serious trouble. In serious danger of judgment from an almighty, all-powerful God. Yet again, there were men that were willing to stand in the breach. There were men that were willing to stand and speak and pray and act in a way that pleased God. Today, I don't have to say anything that's news to you. I don't have to bring anything that will validate. Indeed, we need men and women to stand in the gap. Because as I said a while ago, there's a lot of things in our world that are lacking. There's a lot of gaps. There's a lot of holes in every aspect. Our nation is the same way. It's a direct result, though, I believe, of a moral condition. I believe that we have the gaps and the holes in Christianity, in our nation, in the world, because of a moral condition. People's attitude towards an almighty God. So the children of Israel found themselves in that same place because of their attitude towards an almighty God. We speak the Lord's name today. And you may talk about it with somebody else, and it means nothing. There's no reverence, there's no respect, there's no holiness. Talk about God's word, and it's a relevant subject. Well, that's relevant for you or relative to you, but it's not to me. Even Christians have strayed away from true devotion to Almighty God. Why? I believe in attempts to fill our own desires, just as the nation of Israel. We've called it Christianity, but it really is more about us. We should start calling it after our own names. Kylianity. Because oftentimes we try to live more according to what we think Christianity is than what the Bible truly says Christianity is. And there's holes. There's holes. There's gaps. We want a convenient relationship. We want a convenient Christianity that oftentimes is put second or third, sometimes even fourth and fifth on the list of our priorities in our life. And we say that we are following Christ when we say we're Christians. Again, this happens often at times at the expense of something that pleases us. So we need men or women that are willing to stand in the gap. I believe that there's some characteristics, three this morning, that I want to identify. And if we don't have men or women that are willing to do these, that aren't willing to stand in the gap, then we definitely and speedily are headed towards judgment. There's things coming, and I'm not saying this to be a scare tactic. This is just the reality. Amen. We stand by and we realize it. We watch the news and we say, what has this world come to? We hear the stories, we read the articles, and we talk to people and we say, what's going on with this country? Even in the church, and we wonder what's happening. Well, that means that you and I, once we've identified the issues, the problems, the gaps, the breaches, we've got to be willing to be the people that stand in the breach. Because if not, who's going to? And so I'm nobody. Neither was Moses when God chose him. But he was willing to do what God wanted him to do. The first thing I want to bring out that people who stand in the gap have, no question in my mind, is they have compassion. People that are willing and people that do stand in the gap have compassion. In every instance, Moses, we can look back in Nehemiah and see Nehemiah. He came back and he saw the breaches. He saw the walls torn down. And the Bible says that he wept. He was brokenhearted for his nation, for his people, for the temple. He was brokenhearted. He wept. He had compassion. Of course, our Lord, Jesus Christ, had compassion. These men, compassion, I believe, ruled in their heart. Compassion for a people that were headed towards judgment. Moses begged and he pleaded. Nehemiah fell on his face crying. Jesus went to the cross. They stood in the gap because they cared. How did they care? Here's the type of compassion that it's to be. They cared beyond themselves. They had compassion for others more than they cared for themselves. They put themselves on the line for others. They said, you know what? It's more important that somebody else benefits than it is for me. Just like those soldiers back in 1812. You and I are sitting here today because those men said, it matters that somebody else benefits at the cost of even my own life. They had compassion. They cared beyond themselves. This is a principle that Jesus taught. It's been taught in this church. It's been preached in this church. Even here recently, the missionary last Wednesday night spoke about it. This compassion, this love is to go beyond ourselves. In John chapter 13 and also in John chapter 15 up on the screen, it says in verse 12, "This is my commandment, that you love one another." How are we supposed to love each other? He says, "As I have loved you." Love one another as I have loved you. Well, what's the best illustration that you can give on how you loved us? Verse 13, "Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends." Again, just like those men at Fort McHenry. Those men and women who are even fighting now for us, they may not even be Christians, but they're counting their lives less than they do for ours, because they're putting their life on the line. How much more should we put effort to stand in the breach as Christians? I think a lot more. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 8 tells us to have compassion one for another. It tells us we're supposed to care for one another. I believe in order to stand in the gap as a nation for our brothers and sisters in Christ, I believe for us to stand in the gap for a people, a lost world that's in need of a Savior. Maybe there's somebody here this morning. You've never trusted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You're walking in darkness. There's no hope in your life. Everything you face brings hopelessness. I'm telling you what, Jesus Christ is the answer. He's the only answer. Surrendering your life to Him is the only hope we have beyond this life. And if you and I as Christians who have the truth aren't willing to stand in the gap for those even lost, cry out to God, "God, give us the heathen. God, give us those lost in our community." If we're not willing to stand in the gap and cry out for that, but also do something about that, then we can't gripe and complain. We can't see these problems in our nation. We can't see the problems in our world and say, "Man, what's it going to take to fix this place?" We know what it's going to take. Jesus told us, "Be salt, be light. Don't keep your gospel hid." It's a responsibility that we have to stand in the breach. But it means that we got to care beyond ourselves. We've got to care further than we do our own household. Care more about others than we do our own life. To plead, to stand up, to work for God, to honor the Lord. To be willing, and not only willing, but be willing to act and to act. And I believe that takes the second characteristic I want to point out this morning. That takes courage. It's easy. I will tell you how easy it is. You can do it every single day. Many of us probably do it every single day. To sit on our couch, to sit behind our computer, read the news, listen to the news, and shake our head, as I said a while ago, and say, "What's this world coming to? What's this world?" That's easy to identify the problems. It's easy to say, "Here's the solution. I see what the solution is." We as Christians need to stand up. How many times do we do that? How many times do we identify what needs to happen, yet don't have this second characteristic enough to act? And that's courage. Because we can sit by, as I said, it's so easy to watch that television, to read that news. It's easy to hear that. I have compassion. My heart is breaking. Our world is going to hell in a handbasket. There's so many problems in our nation. Christians need to stand up. It's easy to do that. But when it comes to standing before God and crying out to God and say, "God, don't judge right now. God, please show mercy. God, please give us more time." When it comes time to actually stand up and thrust the spear through somebody and standing up for what's right, that takes courage. It takes courage to act. Moses was commanded to be courageous. He told the people of Israel, be courageous. He told Joshua, God told Joshua, be strong and very courageous. It takes courage. The Apostle Paul's ministry was characterized by courage. Standing in the breach for a lost people. The Jews and the Gentiles. These men had to have courage. They had to stand. They had to have a faith in God that not only saw the problems, but caused them to act in their compassion out of courage. But these men and women were willing to stand and endure come what may. No matter what they faced. When it got hard, when it got difficult, again, when it even cost their own life, those men at Fort McHenry, as one man fell and gave his life, the next man came and grabbed the pole. And the next came, and the next came. And again, Francis Scott Key couldn't see as he pinned the poem, the Star-Spangled Banner, what we have today. He couldn't see those men's bodies laying on top of one another as they held that flag up. But they were willing to do that because they not only cared, but they had an amazing amount of courage in the face of an all-out attack. Paul explains what he had to go through and his missionary team had to go through in doing and standing in the breach for a lost world in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. He explains what their lives went through. They were always in jeopardy, always on the verge of death for the cause of Christ, but, listen, for the benefit of others. And he says that. Starting in verse 15, he had just made the point that they go through all these things. They're pressed, they're crushed, they're cast out, they're persecuted, but God's in control. And then he says this in verse 15, for all things are for your sakes. He was writing to the Corinthians. We're going through all of this trouble. We're standing with courageous hearts. We're going through this for a reason, and you're the reason. It's for your benefit. Why, though? Why? Why were they willing to do that? That the abundant grace might, through the thanksgiving of many, redound to the glory of God. As I said a while ago, they were willing to stand with courageous hearts and act with courageous hearts for the cause of Christ, but for the benefit of others. They cared, and they were courageous. Look what he says, verse 16. For which cause, that cause, that God might be glorified, for which cause we faint not. We're not going to give up. We're not going to quit. We're not going to stop. We're not going to let up. We're going to keep pushing forward with courageous hearts because it matters. But though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. Verse 17, look what he compares this to. And if you want, you can look in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, I believe it is, and get a good idea of what Paul and his missionary team went through. He talks about the shipwrecks. He talks about the persecution, the imprisonments, the stonings, being nigh to death, being put in front of beasts and animals to be killed. He talks about a great distress that they were in. And look what he says in verse 17, for our light affliction. Light affliction? I believe if I face one of those things for the cause of Christ, my heart might start growing a little faint. The Apostle Paul had a great amount of courage. And he calls their affliction, which was great to all of us, he says, for our light affliction, which is but for a moment, it's just a short amount of time, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen, they're temporal. But the things which are not seen are eternal. Paul was driven by compassion. God got a hold of his heart, and he was willing to give his all for the cause of Christ. But he cared for others, and he had a courageous heart enough to act in that. It takes an extreme amount of courage, a whole lot of courage, to stand in the breach for people you may never meet. That's why I so respect our military. They're dying. They're putting their lives on the line for you and I, people they'll maybe never meet. What an amazing amount of courage that takes. But this world is just temporal. And the things we see are temporal. There's an eternal cost. There's an eternal price. There's an eternal weight that Paul saw. And he was willing to give his life for that cause. It's the cause of Christ, the glory of God. And he said, I'm going to lay down my life for Christ. To die is gain. Paul said, you know what? I'm going to give my all. Again, what an amazing amount of courage. People willing to give their lives for people they never meet. People maybe that are living a life full of selfishness and sinfulness. It takes a lot of selflessness to do that. Give your life for somebody who may talk bad about you. Lay down your life. Serve somebody that don't care about you. Live and give the gospel to people that'll spit on you, that don't care for you, that would love to rule over you. And still be willing to stand in the gap. They might kill you. It takes an amazing amount of courage. In America, in the church, sadly we find a lot of people, I believe, that just don't care. Maybe playing a religious game is sufficient enough. Maybe they call themselves Christians, but they're not in church at all. And they're just completely engulfed in sin. No matter what, maybe it's that person who doesn't care that there's some Christian praying for them. They don't care. Maybe to the point of being ugly to us. I don't care what you Christians do. I don't care that you're praying for me. Maybe that's the attitude they have. Maybe they don't care that someone is standing in the gap for them. We've got to be willing to do so no matter what. It might cost us something. It might cost us everything. It might cost us our time. It may require of us our treasures. It may require of us our very lives. But it takes courage to do that. I don't know about you, but I'm getting sick and tired, this is an old phrase, of being sick and tired of what I see in the news, of what the status quo is for America. I'm sick and tired of that. I'm sick and tired of the church. I want us as the church, as Rochelle's saying, we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. We are, this is the present. God is here in us as Christians. And as the church gathers together, why would we not use every resource? Why would we not pour our very lives out to stand in the breach? Again, I think sometimes it's because maybe our hearts have grown callous. Maybe we've focused on so many things that are temporal. We've fallen into the cracks that have identified and defined us as a nation right now. And Christians are no different. Why won't we change? Why do we not want to do? Why can't we stand in the gap? Why can't we have the courage? Maybe it's sin. Maybe it's a lack of courage. Maybe we just don't have the heart to do it. I care. I do care. I want to see things change, but I can't make a stand in my home. My wife, my husband, my kids, they're going to rebel. It's not going to be good. It's for me and my house. We will serve the Lord. We need men that are going to stand in the breach in their homes. We need men and women that are going to stand in the breach in the church. And it's not going to change until it changes there for our nation. And this last one, it's not just about standing once. It's not just about having courage at some point in time. It's a dedicated effort, period. The third point is this, commitment. Three characteristics of someone who is standing in the breach. There's no doubt we're going to see that they care. They have a compassion for others more than they have for themselves. That they have courage, not just to care, but to act. But not just to act one time or to stand one time, but to be committed. We could say that it's a commitment based on a conviction. Listen, it matters. It's worth it. God said so. Whatever the conviction is, it's a commitment based on a conviction that it's worth it. Many would look at the direction of America and say, you know what, we're too far off track now. You look at the government, you look at the direction of that, we're too far gone, and there's no reason for us as Christians to stand in the breach anymore. We shouldn't try that hard. There's no reason. I've been trying for these many years and nothing has changed. That's exactly what Satan wants. Hey, have your compassion. Have your courage. Do it one time here. You can win a battle here. You can win a battle there. That's okay. I'm not going to quit. Eventually, you're going to stop. You're going to quit being dedicated. You're not going to have the commitment it takes to stand in the breach for the long term. And that's when I'll finish the work that I wanted to finish. All Satan wants is to see us at one time say, you know what, I can't do it anymore. I can't stand for the right. I can't witness for God anymore. I can't stand up in my home. I can't do it anymore. It's too hard. I give up. I quit. That's what Satan's looking for, because that's what has happened in our nation. For whatever reason, again, maybe it's our own lust, like it was for the children of Israel in the wilderness. They were lusting after things. They weren't grateful for what God had. They were lusting after other things, and it drew their heart away from God. And it ended up costing them in a great way. We've got to have people that are willing to be committed. And so, again, it's too far off course. Our country is so far gone. Brother Kyle, there's people in our country, a lot of people in our country, that care more about taking guns away from people because they're killing kids than they are about the daily massacre of about 2,200 children a day. That's right, I said 2,200 children a day being massacred. And they care more, and this is not a political thing, I promise you not. It's an identification of where we are as a people. To give a clear picture, I want to share something from the CDC, the Center for Disease Control. It says this: nearly all states report abortion numbers to the federal government, but it's voluntary. To be exact, they say there's 43 states that voluntarily submit statistics on abortion to the federal government. One of those states that could be voluntary, that doesn't, is California, which has the largest population and the largest number of abortion providers. So these numbers don't include the state of California. Experts believe that there are more than a million abortions performed nationwide in America every year. But because of the incomplete reporting, the CDC had reports in 2009 of this number, 784,507, listen, legal abortions. The abortion rate for 2009, this is almost 4 years ago now, was 15.1 abortions per 1,000 women in America. 15 per 1,000. And that was ages 15 to 44. Listen to this. The abortion ratio in 2009 was 227 abortions per 1,000 live births. And yet there are more concerns about economy and money and other things in our world. And we say, what's going on with our nation? What's going on with our world? What's wrong with us? It's because we care more for the things that bring us pleasure and please our flesh than we care about the things of God and what's right in His Word. Men and women have said, you know what, we're not going to stand in the gap anymore because it's too hard. We've been standing this long, and we're not going to be committed to it anymore. This is just one area that our nation's off course. Again, it's in churches. It's Christians supposed to be God's children. And our concerns for culture are higher than our concerns for Christ. Why? Scripture says this in Psalms 33, and I'm almost done. It says this in verse 12, blessed. If you got a Bible, I would turn your Bibles to Psalm 33, open up verse 12, and I would underline verse 12. In the very beginning, it says, blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. If the nation is blessed who makes God their Lord, then what does it say for the nation who doesn't make God their Lord? Cursed, judged, doomed is the nation whose God isn't the Lord. To stand in the gap, to stand in the breach, it's going to take people who care, who have compassion, who go beyond themselves and say, you know what, it's more about others than it is about me. I'm saved. I'm on my way to heaven. I've got my assurance in Christ. I know, and my life is going to be poured out for the cause of others. I'm going to stand in the breach, even if it costs me my life, even if it costs me everything that I have. I'm going to stand in the gap. I'm going to stand in the breach. I'm going to stand up with a courageous heart. I'm going to act, and I'm going to be committed to the very end. the end of my life, the end of the world, whatever comes, I'm going to stand in the gap because it matters. As I close, I'm going to share two other examples of people that stood in the gap. The first one is Corrie Ten Boom. And for some reason, when I was studying, God just laid her on my mind, on my heart, and I thought, that was someone who stood in the gap. A Christian lady who risked imprisonment, who risked death, standing in the breach for God's people during the time of Nazi Germany. She was from the Netherlands, and her family had a commitment, a dedication. They had devoted themselves to harboring, protecting several Jews from the Nazis for many years. They even made places in their home, safe places, hidden places to protect God's people. It was risking their own well-being. It was risking their own life, her writings were examples, an example to us. They say, women say, well, the men need to. That's right, the men need to, but the women need to as well. Corrie Ten Boom was willing to stand in the gap. She no doubt had compassion. She no doubt had a courage to stand. Even when her attackers hauled her off to an imprisonment, even when they hauled her off to a death camp, her and her sister, she had a commitment. Even in the most horrific circumstances that we can imagine. Circumstances so horrible that the stench, the maggots, the flies were so bad that the officers, the German soldiers wouldn't even go into certain areas because of it. A woman willing to stand in the breach in those conditions, even after her release, continuing to stand in the breach. That's commitment for the cause of Christ, the preservation of people, preservation of God's people. Standing in the gap. She stood in the gap. If you want to take some time to be inspired by a woman of great resolve, I would encourage you to look up Corrie Ten Boom and read about her life of prayer. Read about her. Read some of her writings. Very encouraging. And the last person as the musician comes that I want to talk about is a person that we laid to rest last Monday. The name of Chester Reed. A man that was willing to stand in the breach, just like those soldiers did in 1812. He served his nation, just like many of you in here have served our country. A man that stood in the breach, serving his nation. But he also stood in the breach by leading his family. Even when he was diagnosed with a terminal disease, when he was down to no strength at all, still standing in the gap, still standing in the breach. Man willing to say, you know what, I'm not going to compromise. He was a man of sincere compassion. He cared. He was a man that had great courage, but he was also a man of great commitment. Many of you witnessed his commitment as he was rolled in week after week in a wheelchair. Couldn't do it on his own strength, but he was determined to be committed to the very end. And he prayed. I remember one of the greatest testimonies I can remember. They couldn't go out. They couldn't do everything that they wanted to do. Brother Woody gave a testimony at the funeral last week of the things that they did when he could do it. Going to visit people in hospitals. But they wanted to be a part of the church's outreach, but they couldn't go like they wanted to go. So they would come up and they determined to lead the group that was going to stay behind and pray because they couldn't go. He was a man that was committed. We see more men and women that are following that same path. Brother Eugene, walking, standing in the breach, doing everything he can for the Lord, committed to the very end. Their wives standing right beside them all along. Standing in the breach is necessary. I could begin to list name after name of men and women who I've seen. That's 24 years that I've been here. That have stood in the breach. That have faced all kinds of odds, faced all kinds of attacks, faced all kinds of problems and circumstances, and were willing to say, it matters, I care. I have the courage enough to stand, and I'm going to do it till the very end. I'm going to be committed. But the question is this morning. Are we one of those people who are standing in the breach today? Are we standing in the breach? Maybe you're one that has stood in the breach in the past.
Maybe you cared about others more than you cared for yourself, and you were courageous enough to serve God and to stand in the gap and stand for the right and be faithful, and you were committed to it. You were serving God. You were leading your family. You were doing all those things. But that commitment has faded. You're no longer standing like you used to stand. You care. But maybe you don't have the courage. Maybe at one point in time you had the heart and you had the courage again, but you lost your commitment. This morning, maybe you've come to a place where it's time to get that back. Maybe you've come to a place that, you know what, I'm tired. I'm tired of just being okay with just cruising by. I want to be one that God says, you're one of my faithful chosen. I want you to stand in the gap, and I answer that call, and I stay committed to the very end. That's what it's going to take. If there's anything that's ever going to change in Christianity, in America, in our world, it's going to take Christians, even in a room like this size. It doesn't take a mega church to decide to do it. It was one person in Moses' day. It said that he stood in the breach, and God withheld his judgment. It was one person when it was Phineas. Guess what? Jesus Christ was the example for all of us. It was one person. He was the only person who could do what he did, but he stood in the breach. And he became that bridge for you and I to have a relationship with God so that we too could stand in the breach for him. And we could stand up. Are we willing to care for others more than we care for ourselves? That's the compassion it's going to take. Do you care for others, your neighbors, people in this community, more than you care for yourself? Are you willing to stand? Even if no one else is, are we willing to stand alone? Willing to keep the course to the very end? If not, this morning, let's make a commitment. Let's make a decision. God, I want to be one that stands in the gap. God, when you call my number, when you call my name, when you call me home, God, I want to be found faithful, committed to you. One of those standing in the gap for my brothers and sisters, for the lost people that I care about, for my nation, for my country. God, I want to be found committed to standing in the gap. Let's pray. Father, we come before you. We thank you for this day. God, help me, Lord. I don't want to let up. I don't want to fall short. I don't want to miss the mark, God, of being who you want me to be. And God, I pray that for every single one of us. All of us who are your children, God, help us to be those that are standing in the gap. There may not be many other churches willing to make the stands that are necessary. And even if there's not any, Lord, help us be one that stands. Lord, start with me. Lord, help us stand. Help us care about others more than we care for ourselves. And God, give us the courage to act, Lord, not just to talk, not just to worry or be concerned, but give us the courage to act, to share your truth, to stand for what's right. And Lord, help us do that with a commitment to the very end. Lord, I pray for those that are in here that may be lost, that they've come this morning, maybe they've been coming for years, or maybe it's their first time, but they don't know that when they die, that heaven's their home. God, I pray that they heard this morning an amazing love story, that you gave your only son for their sins, for the sins of the whole world, and died in our place for those sins. Lord, I pray that they would know that you love them so much that you did that for them. They would place their faith in you, the fact that you are God, that you rose from the dead, and you offered them salvation. God, I pray that you would tug on their heart, that they would answer that call. And I pray for us Christians, Lord, that we would answer the call this morning, Lord. That we would stand in the gap. Those maybe that have given up, those maybe who aren't committed or maybe care but don't have the courage, I pray that you would do whatever is necessary this morning. Just do a great work and we'll praise you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. If you'll stand with us for just a minute, let's stand in the breach because it's worth it.
Look at the Savior in my
Praise God. Thank you so much again for being here this morning. We're excited what God has in store again. Praise God for 28 years, 28 great years, Trinity Baptist Temple. And thank you so much again for being here. And we do something. If you're a guest, we acknowledge birthdays and anniversaries on Sunday morning. So if you've had a birthday or anniversary this week, or you got one coming up, if you'll come down here so we can sing to you. Praise the Lord. Josiah, you want to come up here so everybody can sing happy birthday to you? Yeah? Okay. Come on. You'd come over here. Yeah. Poor little guy broke his collarbone. I think John and Becky did it. We were joking about that yesterday. So people are going to think that we did it. No. No, they really did. No. No, there was an accident at his school, and his teacher tried to tackle him. And no, she fell up against him and fell to the ground. And did you push her off you? No? She fell on you. What else happened after that? He's going to show us. He cried when he hit the wall. Yeah. Did you cry? Yeah. That hurts, he said. Well, let's sing happy birthday and then happy anniversary. Praise God. Are you going to slide down it? There you go. Broken collarbone. There you go. That's awesome. Sorry about that. Caused such a commotion there. Well, praise God. Well, I'd like to ask if you are a senior citizen or if you have, if you're a diabetic, if you go ahead and start heading that way and get in line, please do so. I'd also like at this time to ask our charter members if you guys would go ahead and head that way as well. Diabetics, senior citizens, and charter members. Well, let's pray, and we'll bless the food, and everybody else can get in line behind them, all right? Father, we come before you. We thank you for this day. We thank you for allowing us just to be in your house, God. I just thank you again for your word. God, help us to stand in the gap. Help us be a people that stands in the gap. Lord, I pray that you would just bless the fellowship next door. Thank you for the food. Thank you for those that prepared it and spent so much time on it, Lord. I just pray you bless it and nourish it to our bodies. And God, we pray that you'd just be honored in all that we do today. And we just again thank you. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Don't forget, no PM service this evening.